Good morning, everyone, and welcome to class. Hope you all had a good weekend. All of you in-person students, all of you look tired. Okay. I hope all our online students had a good weekend, refreshing weekend. Welcome to our e-learning students as well. We'll begin. Okay. Can I ask one of us to lead us in prayer, please? Anyone can lead us in prayer? Rin, the mic is near you, so. Yeah.
Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this day that you have given us. And Lord, we don't take you for granted that that you have just poured out your grace and your mercy to us. And Lord, as we have gathered today to learn more of your word and to know more of Jesus, I pray that you would help our minds to be opened, and that you help us understand what is being taught, and that you help Pastor Selena to teach us well. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this time. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Were you able to hear Rin as she prayed, online students? Okay, yes. Thank you, Chira. Okay, Anthony says yes. Okay, so last class we began talking about the kingdom of God. Okay, we discovered that God's original intent was to establish a people, and also establish a kingdom, establish a people who would be co-heirs with him in that kingdom, which means that God wanted us to inherit his kingdom and rule along with him in his kingdom. Okay. We also looked at how God introduced the kingdom in the Garden of Eden. Okay. And how it was lost. And then we went on to see how Jesus came and reintroduced the kingdom of God, and how you and I have been invited to inherit that kingdom. Okay, it's an invitation that is left to us, which means it's a choice that you and I make. Today we're going to look at the king of this kingdom, okay, and we'll focus on God as king, and then we look at how Jesus introduced the kingdom of God here on the earth, or the kingdom of heaven here on the earth. What method did he use to introduce the kingdom of God on the earth? And then if we have time, we will look at chapter 3, which is, you know, looking at the relationship the church has with the kingdom of God. So today we'll look at chapter 2, the king of the kingdom. Okay, who is the king of the kingdom? God. God is the king of the kingdom. We perceive God in different ways. Yes or no? Yes? How do we perceive God? How do each of you perceive God? Okay. How do you, what, when you think about God, what do you think about him? Father? Friend? Okay. What else? How do you perceive God? Okay. We're thinking about more in terms of, you know, like he's a father, he's a friend, following his words, okay? He's almighty. Thank you, Nina John. What else? Holy. All powerful. He's our savior, okay? He's our healer, he's Lord, he's shepherd, deliverer. So we perceive God in different, many different ways, okay? But the Bible also brings to our attention that God is king, okay? Sometimes we don't look at God as king because why do we fail to look at God as king sometimes? Yes, we are more introduced to that. Yeah, he's been more introduced to a, like a more personal aspect of God. He's like our friend, our savior, somebody who's redeemed us, okay, somebody who leads us as a shepherd, So very personal God, an intimate God. That is very nice. But also we need to look at God, and the Bible brings to our attention that God is King. And we need to relate to God as King. Okay. We need to relate to also, even as we relate to God as a healer, as a father, as a savior, as a friend, as a redeemer, somebody who is almighty. We also need to relate to God as a king, somebody who's a ruler, somebody who's Lord over everything. Okay. So even in today's class, I'll be just giving a lot of extra notes. So if you can look at your textbooks, and if there is, you know, you want to make down your own notes, that's good and fine. Okay. So Psalm 145 verse 1. Can somebody read that? Psalm 145 verse 1, please. Even online students, you all can join in, and please unmute your mics and read. So,
Psalms 145, 1, I will extol you, my God, O King, and I will bless your name forever and ever.
Yeah, so the psalmist is saying, you know, I will worship you, okay? I will extol you, God, my King. So he's worshiping God as King. And then look at what the psalmist says in verses 10 to verse 13 of the same chapter. Can somebody read that, please?
All your works shall praise you, O Lord, and your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and talk of your power, to make known to the Son of Man his mighty acts and the glorious majesty of his kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations.
So here the psalmist is worshiping God as King, and he's saying that, God, your people are going to talk about what? Your works. What else? The glory of your kingdom, your power, his mighty acts, the greatness of his kingdom, and what else? His dominion, his majesty, and his kingdom. And they will affirm that God's kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. So that is what the psalmist is saying. He's saying, you know, God, you are King. We worship you as King. And then he says, all the people will acknowledge all of these aspects that we looked at about the King. Okay, so here we are, the psalmist is saying, God, we are recognizing you and we're worshiping you as King. Okay, look at Psalm chapter 47 verse 6. Can somebody read Psalm 47 verse 6, please? Psalm 47 verse 6.
Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises.
The next verse also, please.
For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with understanding.
Amen. So the psalmist here in Psalm chapter 47 verse 6 is saying, 6 and 7 is saying that, you know, sing praises to God, sing praises to your King. Sing praises, for God is King of all the earth. Sing praises with understanding, right? So when we come to worship God, the psalmist is saying, you know, you can do it this way. Okay, when you come to worship God, when you come to praise him, you know, you can praise this King, you can worship this King this way. So he's saying, can you, you know, sing praises to the King? Can you do it as singing praises to the King? And how about when we sing with this heart attitude that says, God, you are King, and I'm singing praises to this King. Okay, so when we are worshiping God, when we're singing praises to him, we're saying, God, you know, this is my tribute. Okay, this is my offering that I'm bringing to you. This is the way I am exalting you. This is the way I'm acknowledging you as King over my life. Okay, so as King, the psalmist is basically saying, let's worship this King. Let's praise him. So when we praise and worship this king, how do we go about praise and worship this king? You know, when we are praising him and worshiping him, we are basically saying, God, I'm here to worship you. I'm bringing my tribute. I'm bringing my offering. This is the way I'm exalting you and acknowledging you as king over my life. Okay. Even in our prayer, we can acknowledge God as king. Okay. Very interesting verse in Psalm chapter 44, verse 4. Okay, very, very powerful, very interesting verse. Please, somebody read Psalm chapter 44, verse 4, please.
You are my King, O God.
Yes, read.
You are my King, O God. Command victories for Jacob.
Yes. You know, it says here that the psalmist says, you are my King, O God. Command victories for Jacob. Okay, very powerful verse, a very short phrase, a very short verse, but it's so powerful. So what the psalmist is basically saying is, God, even as I recognize you as the king of my life, okay, even as you are the king of this universe, and in the light of this fact that you are my king, or in the light of the fact that you are king, here is what I want you to do. And so he's saying, God, I want you to issue decrees. I want you to issue commands of victory for Israel and Jacob. Look at the we can say audacity of the psalmist, or we can talk about it and say, look at the way that the psalmist is actually telling God. But he's actually looking at God as king, and he's saying, God, even as you are king over Israel and Jacob, and as a king makes decrees, and as a king makes, commands, so he's saying, God, issue decrees and issue commands of victory. What is he asking God to issue commands for? Victory. Okay. Now, the word victory in Hebrew is simply the word for salvation. Okay. Saved. Sozo. Okay. And it's an all-inclusive word from which we get also the name Yeshua or Jesus. Okay. So salvation also means the word save. Wherever we read saved or save in the New Testament, it means sozo. In certain places in the New Testament, that means salvation. And salvation is a comprehensive word. It's an all-inclusive word. And from which word we also get the name Yeshua, or we get the name Jesus. So it's a word that not only just means victory, salvation or sozo, just does not mean victory, but it also means healing. It means forgiveness of sins. It means deliverance. It means prosperity. It means well-being, protection from all harm and danger. So here, David is acknowledging God as king. And he's saying, God, because you are king, command, or decree victory over Israel and Jacob. So how about when you and I pray, and we pray in the light of this fact that God is king, and we go to God and say, God, even as you are king over my life, I want you to issue a decree and command over this area of my life so it can be healing. I want you to issue and decree a command of victory over healing. Or you can say, God, even as you're king over my life, I want you to issue and command a decree of victory over my finances. Or I want you to issue a decree and command of victory over my children, or over my marriage, or some area of your life that is that you see is God, there is no move, it's good as dead, whatever area you want to see victory in, you can say, God, I want you to command and decree victory over this situation, over this area, over this part of my life. So issue decrees for healing, issue decrees for deliverance, command victories of the Lord over your life. And so you can say, God, you are king. Your word is your decree. And, when you speak, it will be done. It's a yes and amen. No one can question it. And I'm praying according to your will. And I want you to issue and command this decree of victory. And when we do that, it's not actually we are being arrogant or we are, you know, like we can say that Psalmist was very, look at his audacity, you know, but we can just say, God, even as we're saying this, we're saying, God, I trust in you 100%. I have the faith and trust and the confidence that you will do this for me. So amen, right? Such a powerful verse that we can just speak this verse over the areas of our life. So this understanding of God as King can not only affect the way we worship and praise our God, but also affect the way we pray to our God who is King. So saying, God, if you command it, I know it will be done because you are the omnipotent ruler of the entire world. And I believe that you would do this for me. Amen. Yeah. So we look at a few insights about God as King. Some of them, are very obvious to us, but just like to remind us when we are looking at God as King, just like to remind us about a few insights about him being King and as the one who has the kingdom. Okay. So just a few insights. The first one, as King, God is final authority. Authority is inherent in who he is. Okay. Authority is inherent, means authority is something that is natural in him, something that is characteristic of God. And nobody votes God into power. Okay. We vote the government into power, but nobody votes God into power, and nobody can vote him out of power. Okay. If you like God as King, good. If you don't like God as King, too bad, because he's still going to be King, and your opinion will not change the fact that he is King, and that is authority is inherent in himself, which means authority is characteristic of who God is. It is part of his nature, okay, of who he is. And we know that God does not derive his authority from anyone. He is the final authority. What he says, what he does stands, and no one can question that, no one can come against that. So the first insight about God as King is that he is the final authority. Okay. Secondly, as King, God's word is also his command. His law is his command. Okay. So when God says something, nobody can debate about it. Nobody can question that. Nobody can argue against that. And there is nobody who can vote whether that should become a law or not. His word is his command. It's his law. Okay. Thirdly, as King, his presence is also the place of his authority and glory. So when you enter the presence of the King, you're basically entering the presence of his complete glory and authority, okay? Because the presence of the King is a presence where there is authority and glory, okay? So let me just try to relate this to something with our own, everyday experience that we have in our normal everyday life. Now, when you're meeting a friend, and you sit and talk with that friend, what will be your, the way that you do it? Will you be very formal with a friend? You'll just be very normal. You'll just be very, very casual. You'll even just dress up very casually. Maybe if it's summer or now it's not raining, it's not cold in Bangalore. So you just wear shorts and maybe just go with a t-shirt and very casually you will talk with your friend. Okay. So when you sit and talk, you're not worried about anything. But if just say if you're meeting the president of your organization, okay, or you're meeting Pastor Ashish Raichur, you have to go to his office, okay, how will you go? Huh? Very formally dressed. You'll also be wondering why is he called you? There'll be a lot of anxiety, okay, but you won't go with a very casual attitude, right? When you go to meet the president of your organization, you'll go well-dressed, best-dressed, you'll be on time, you'll be ahead of time. And then you enter the presence of that person or that dignitary with, a lot of respect, because his presence actually commands authority that is behind him, okay? Now, just imagine you are going to meet the president of India or the prime minister. How will your attitude be? That's even more weightier, right? You kind of wear the best clothes, and then you're entering the presence of this dignitary, and his presence represents his authority that is behind him. Now, we scale it up infinite times when we enter the presence of the Almighty God, who is King of Kings, who is Lord of Lords, who is Almighty, All-Powerful, who is the only King of the Earth. So we have to scale up, you know, the way we enter his presence infinite times. And in his presence, there is all of his authority, all of his glory that represents him right there in his presence. Okay. So actually, you and I have the awesome privilege, the great privilege of walking into that awesome presence of this great King who is mighty, all powerful, omnipotent, and you know, who is so great and almighty. Okay. So that is what we mean when we say in the third point, as King, his presence is also a place of his authority and his glory. Okay. Now, the fourth point, you know, follow up in your book, you know, so that you are, you can just make any notes, whatever you want. Okay. Number four, the fourth point, as King, God's name represents the full weight of his authority. Okay. So his name also has his authority, not only his presence, but also his name. Now, when we mention the name of somebody who's achieved something great, or is somebody in a great higher position, we immediately respond to that name in a meaningful way, in a very reverential way. Why? Because that name carries weight and authority. We don't take it lightly, right? If you say Pastor Ashish has said something, we all will follow in line, you know, we'll just do it. Okay. So also the name of God as King, his name represents the full weight of his authority. Okay. That is why demons even shudder and shiver at the name of Jesus. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that he is Lord. At the name of Jesus, there is power. There's healing, there's deliverance, there's encouragement, there's provision, you name it, and everything is there because that name represents the full weight of his authority. Amen? Okay, point five. As King, God's kingdom is an expression of who he is. So whatever happens in God's kingdom, it's very important for God because he is King. And God desires that his kingdom be a true representation or a true expression of who he is as King. So God wants his kingdom to exactly represent who he is, represent his nature, and also a true expression of the King. So the kingdom actually represents who the King is. So the King is slack and is lazy, then we see things not, you know, there's chaos in the kingdom. But if a king is orderly, you know, does everything with a plan and a purpose and is strict, then there's order, there's no chaos in the kingdom. If a king is very, selfish, self-centered, and, you know, has no love, but is always thinking about himself, then we see that the people in his, you know, kingdom struggle. There is no love. There is no happiness. There is no joy. Okay. So the kingdom is the representative of the King. So God wants his kingdom to be a true expression, a true representation of who he is as King. And he doesn't treat it lightly when things happen in his kingdom. Okay. He wants to make sure, or he ensures, that what happens in his kingdom is a true expression of who he is as King. Okay. Now, what do we know about God as King? Okay. What do we know about God as King? What do we know about this King who is King of this kingdom? Okay. What are the facets of God as king. A very familiar scripture passage that we often read during Christmas time, but we will be looking at it now as God as king, is Isaiah chapter 9 verses 6 and 7. Okay, so can somebody please read Isaiah chapter 9 verses 6 and 7, please?
For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end, upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice, from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this.
Amen. So, what kind of king is he? Okay, here it says his name is Wonderful. You know, when you look at this word wonderful in the Hebrew, it literally means miraculous. So actually here his name is called Miraculous. He's counselor. Counselor means an advisor. Okay, the wise one, basically meaning the advisor or the wise one. It also says he is the Mighty God. Mighty God means what? Omnipotent in power. Okay. So wonderful literally means miraculous. Counselor means somebody who's an advisor or the wise one. Mighty God means omnipotent in power. And he is the everlasting Father. Okay, that means he's has no beginning, no end. He's always our Father, and he's a ruler of the Prince of Peace. He's a ruler. Okay, and he's a Prince of Peace. Okay, and verse 7 says, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end, upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. So here is a description of the king who's carrying on his shoulders. What is he carrying on his shoulders? The government, or the weight of his kingdom, or his government. And his kingdom is what kind of a kingdom? Everlasting kingdom. And his kingdom will continue to grow and expand, and there will be no end to it. Okay. So what kind of king is there at the center of this government? Everlasting Father, somebody who's wonderful, miraculous, counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, an advisor, the wise one. And so he wants his kingdom to be filled with all of these attributes of who he is. Okay. And he wants his kingdom to be filled with, to be saturated with the miraculous, because he's wonderful, which means he's miraculous. So he wants his kingdom to be saturated with the miraculous. Saturated means what? Full and overflowing with the miraculous. So miracles are basically surprise gifts from God, and that is what he wants his kingdom to be full of. He wants his kingdom to be full of the miraculous. His name is also Counselor, which means he's the advisor, the wise one, which means he wants his kingdom to be filled with his wisdom and people walking in the wisdom of God. Okay. He's also the Mighty God, which means the God of power and omnipotence, or the God of power or of omnipotence. And so nothing can obstruct his plans or his purposes, and what he wants to fulfill on the earth, nothing will stop him from doing that. Okay. And he's also Mighty God, which means, he's God who's mighty and powerful. So he will rule his kingdom with might and power. And he is the Everlasting Father, which means as a king, he's also very compassionate. He cares for the needs of his people, just like a father cares for his children. So also God is compassionate and loving and caring. He's a father to the needy, to the poor, to the oppressed. He's willing to, as a father, to step into our troubles. He's willing to come alongside to encourage us, to be a father to us. So our King is also our Father. Okay? And He is also the ruler of peace. He's a Prince of Peace. Prince of Peace means what? Ruler of peace. The Hebrew word for peace is shalom. And what does shalom mean? Also a very comprehensive word. Wholeness, well-being, which means He's a King who enforces wholeness throughout His kingdom. He brings wholeness and peace into every one of His people's life. Okay, so the King desires His kingdom to be an expression of Himself. All of this. So even as you are part of God's kingdom, you can say, God, even as you are King of this kingdom, and I am co-heir with you and I'm part of this kingdom, I also want your wisdom to be operative in my life. I want wholeness, God. I want peace. I want well-being. I want, I want your power to be manifested in my life. I want every time that I preach or teach or lead worship or pray for somebody, I want to see the miraculous, because that is an expression of your kingdom. That is what your kingdom is all about. Okay. And verse 7, it also says His judgment and justice will be throughout His kingdom and His rule. Okay. So that is also that we want to see. We say, God, I want to see judgment and I want to see justice done in your kingdom. Now, when we talk about the kingdom of God, we usually tend to emphasize only one aspect of the King's nature. Sometimes we just focus only on the miraculous. And, you know, some people can say the kingdom of God is all about the miraculous. Okay. Yes, it's all about Him being wonderful. That means a miracle worker. It's true. But it's just one aspect of His kingdom. Some others can say, hey, the kingdom of God is all about Him being a father to us. Or the kingdom of God is all about Him being, of us experiencing shalom. Or the kingdom of God is all about just judgment and justice of God. If the Old Testament people, you know, we're here, they would say God's kingdom is all about judgment and justice. For you and I, some of us, it can be just that He is a father, or He's a miracle working God, or He is, God who gives us peace, a God who gives us well-being. So sometimes we tend to focus on just one or two aspects of this King and His kingdom. But, you know, it's and when we relate to Him in just one of these aspects, you know, we fail to represent Him in the fullest sense. You know, we ultimately misrepresent Him. So what we need to do is we actually need to relate to God with all of who He is and all of who He expresses Himself in His kingdom, or all of who, or all of what He represents Himself to be in His kingdom. Okay. So when you and I represent God, we need to represent Him with all of these things. Okay, that's when we are preaching with peace, with miracles, we are preaching with the love of God, or whatever we are doing in the kingdom of God, whether it's laying out the chairs, or whether it is serving tea, or whether it is cleaning or washing. When we do it with all of the nature of God and what His kingdom represents, then we would not be misrepresenting Him. Okay, so the King is more than just a father. He's more than just a miraculous. He's more than just the Prince of Peace, but He represents all of who He is. The full facets of who God is all represented in His kingdom. So He's all this and more, and He wants His kingdom to be the full expression of who He is. He wants His kingdom to be a full expression of Himself. Okay. Now the point 6, as King, God is to be feared and honored. So we will read Jeremiah chapter 10 verse 7. And also verse 10. So can somebody read Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 7 and verse 10, please?
Who would not fear you, O King of the nations? For this is your rightful due.
for among all the wise men of the nations, and in all their kingdoms, there is none like you.
Amen. Verse 10 also, yes.
Verse 10. But the Lord is the true God. He is the living God and the everlasting King. At his wrath, the earth will be trembled, and the nations will not able to endure his
indignation. So here it says, God is King of the nations. Okay, Jeremiah chapter 10 verse 7 says, you know, he's God of the nations. And because he's the God of the nations, what should we do? What should be our attitude? We have to fear him, honor him, give him the reverence that is due to him as King. Okay, he is to be feared and honored as King. Okay, and he says, for this is your rightful due, for among all the wise men of the nations and all their kingdoms, there is none like you. There is none like God who is King, and so we need to give him rightfully what he is due. Okay, and also verse 10 says that he is the everlasting King, and at his wrath the earth will tremble and the nations will not be able to endure his indignation. Now, one of the greatest tributes God as King comes from the mouth of a pagan king. You know who that is? Nebuchadnezzar. King Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. Okay, he knew nothing about this God of the Hebrews, and he was a king who ascended to such great heights of power on this earth. He established the Babylonian Empire, and he was so powerful. And then something went wrong in his life. What happened to him? Yes, he lost his mind. He became mad, and he began living like an animal in the forest. And once he got through that time, you know, came back to his normal life, you know, he was ultimately restored. Okay, he now turned back, and when he turns back, he begins to ascribe greatness to the King of all Kings. Okay, very interesting. Look at what King Nebuchadnezzar has to say about God in Daniel chapter 4, verses 34 to 37. So can somebody please read Daniel chapter 4, verse 34, please?
At the end of the time, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted up my eyes to heaven, and my understanding returned to me, and I blessed to the Most High, and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom is from generations to generations.
Amen. So here King Nebuchadnezzar recognizes that, you know, his kingdom will pass away. You know, he will also pass away. He will also die. His kingdom will go to somebody else. But he says the king of this kingdom will never pass away. And he says his dominion, or his rule, his reign, his power, his authority is from everlasting to everlasting. Okay, look at what he says in verse 35. He says, all the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. He does according to his will in the army of heaven, and among the inhabitants of the earth no one can restrain his hand or say to him, what have you done? Okay, so Nebuchadnezzar realized that, hey, I'm a king of a powerful empire. Okay, Babylonian Empire was the most powerful empire. He recognizes that he's a king of a powerful empire, but he says, yet I have my own limitations. Okay, but there is a kingdom whose king is infinitely greater than me, and there is nobody who can contend with him. There's nobody who can stop his path. And he says, I must ascribe greatness to this king. So in the light of looking at this great king of this of God as king, and looking at his kingdom, you know, Nebuchadnezzar is able to understand his own frailty. He's able to understand his own weaknesses. Then look at what he says in verses 36 and 37. Can somebody else please read 36 and 37, please?
At the same time, my reason returned to me, and for the glory of my kingdom, my honor and splendor returned to me. My counselors and nobles resorted to me. I was I was restored to my kingdom, and excellent majesty was added to me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and exalt and honor the King of heaven, all of whose works are truth and his ways justice, and those who walk in pride he is able to put down.
Amen. So he says here, now I realize that there is a king who is greater than me, and I want, what does he want to do to this king? What does he want to do to this king? Yes, praise him, give him all the glory, honor, and worship him as king. Okay, so the king of our kingdom, or the kingdom that we belong to, the king who is God, needs to be feared and honored. Okay, there are many places in the Bible, in the New Testament, that talks about God as our king. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 17 and 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 15. Can somebody read those two verses, please?
Yeah, 1 Timothy 1:17. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. 1 Timothy 6:15, which he will manifest in his own time. He who is the blessed and only potent, the King of kings and the Lord of lords.
Amen. Okay. So here we see in these two passages, okay, talks about God, who is the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who's the only blessed potent. And also we see in 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 17, he's a king who is, he's a king who is, 1 Timothy chapter 17, eternal, immortal, invisible, see, alone who is wise, and to him be all glory, honor forever and ever. Okay, and also there are several other places in scripture where God is worshipped as king. We also can read this in Revelation chapter 17 verse 14 and also Revelation chapter 19 verse 16. So we see in several places in scripture God is called the King of kings and the Lord of lords. So this morning, even as we have just looked at God as king, you know, just part of it, you know, what I like to encourage each one of us is to look at God as king as well, apart from all the other aspects of who he is, his nature, and who has revealed himself to us. And also, even as we begin to look at God as king, worship him as king, what we looked at in Psalm, right? In Psalm chapter 145 verse 1 and verses 10 to 13. And also when you pray, don't forget Psalm chapter 44 verse 4. Very powerful, right? What do we need to pray? Say, God, even as you are king, I want you to command and decree or issue victory over this area of my life. Okay? And just believe that because God is omnipotent, he's powerful, and he can do it. Okay, amen. So we'll move on in this chapter and we'll see how Jesus introduced his kingdom. How Jesus introduced the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven. Are these two terms, kingdom of God and kingdom of heaven, different terms? No, they are the same. They can be used interchangeably. Okay. So when Jesus came into this world, how did he go about introducing the kingdom of God? What did he do? Any idea? There is a forerunner, okay. But when Jesus came introducing the kingdom, how did he introduce the kingdom? Through parables? Repent? What did he do? Okay, miracles. He demonstrated miracles. What else did he do? Teaching, very good. He did all the things to project himself, project the kingdom of God. What are all the things? Okay, he demonstrated miracles, teaching, preaching, and miracles. Teaching, preaching, and miracles. Okay. Okay, fulfilling the prophecies. Okay. So, yes. Can you please use a mic?
So this honor and all. So we have to honor our king. On the other side, he is a very loving God also, right?
Yes.
Like, when we are talking, like when we are going to God, we have to, we have to be with dignity and all. So on the other side, God can accept anywhere, right? Accept us.
Yeah, he accepts us just the way we are. Like, but when you go to your father, you know, your father is loving, right? Your father is caring. But you don't go and talk to him, hey, buy me this, get me this, hey, do this for me. You don't say that. You give him the respect and honor, right? You don't say, hey, come here, let's go to the market, take me, I want to buy this. You don't talk like that. You give him the honor. Dad, can we go? I want this. Please, can you buy me this? We say, please. Or, you know, when you get them, when they get us something, hopefully we say, thank you. I hope we use words like please, thank you, sorry, and all of those things to our parents. You know, sometimes we take them so much for granted. Okay. But we show them respect and honor that way. So we don't talk with them with dishonor. So when we say honor God, it does not mean that, you know, we go with suit and tie and, you know, we a white shirt, white pant, or white salwar and bow down and go like this. No, it just means that we give him the honor that he is due and we don't talk to him also casually and say, what God, you know, you didn't do this for me. What's happening? Where are you? We don't talk. No? Yes, that whole reality comes that, you know, this just stands so amazed at yes, you know, how awesome and mighty and so powerful he is. But yet he's such a God who can so, he's so lovely to us. Nobody is as lovely. Nobody is as kind. Nobody is as gracious and compassionate, patient and merciful as he is to us. I mean, that just blows my mind. It just leaves me dumbfounded. Please use the mic, Sean.
When it comes to God, man, we know he's our God and he's our King. But how do we differentiate from that? Because both of them seem very familiar, if you ask me. Because in God, you have to fear him and honor him. When it comes to a king, you're supposed to fear him and honor him. So how do you differentiate between those two types of authorities?
Don't have to differentiate, Sean, because God is King.
Okay.
It's as simple as that. You don't have to differentiate between, I don't have to differentiate between John and Father. John is my father's name. He's my father, okay. Earthly father.
Oh, okay.
They don't differentiate anything. He's just God and he is King. So even as he's God and he's King, I just know that he's all powerful, almighty, that he can do anything for me and he can come through for me. So that gives me the assurance,
okay,
that he's in control, he's in authority, he's in power. Nothing in my life will happen without him knowing it or without it passing through him. And he has all the authority and power to change things, reverse things, and to work on my behalf.
Okay.
Yeah, anything else? Yes. Any of our students, online students, have any questions? Anything you all need to want to say?
As we have, you have taught, ma'am, like, he is in from one verse, we have taught, like, God, he is like a king who has compassion, you know, who, like, on his people. If he sees us in trouble, he comes and he helps us. So it's like he has compassion to forgive and all, but and we saw, like, it is like a picture of a father who forgives and all. But as a king also, like, if someone does mistake in the kingdom, they will also take him the accountability of it and give punishment to it. So how we can, like,
yes, how do we balance that?
Both of it.
Okay, so how do we balance God as being a just God and a God who's compassionate and gracious? Okay, so we'll look at it after we come back from the break. Okay, we'll go for our break now and then come back. Thank you.